Hi, I'm Andrew.
And I'm Dave, and we're the IB English guys. And today we're going to talk about prose nonfiction, and we're going to apply that to a great paper one passage that was used in the past. We modified it for the new course. We love this. What do we like about prose nonfiction, Andrew?
Well, Mr. Jaws, when I think about prose nonfiction, I think about people like Catherine Boo. I think about Tracy Kidder. I think about Isabel Wilkerson. I think about these fantastic authors who communicate information. They write nonfiction, but they do it in a literary way.
Yeah, many times nonfiction writers are telling a factual information, but they're using literary features to do that. They're using story, they're using figurative language, and this is a great example of creative nonfiction. The guiding question we have for this passage that we've written is as follows. How does the author use the combination of the literary and the scientific to convey his message about the human heart?
Ooh, okay, so I hear keywords such as literary, scientific. Okay, so I think those are the key aspects I want to focus on when I'm thinking about language choices. Which ones are literary, which ones are scientific?
Exactly. And we know that this is going to be about the human heart. So we're going to give this passage, we're going to think about our thing that we've talked about before is that we're going to have three drafts of reading. The first reading, we're going to read it aloud. We want to think about first impressions.
Yeah, folks. The second time we read the passage, that's time to get out your pen and jot down some ideas in the margin. What are the dominant ideas you see in the text? What happens on the third draft, Mr. Giles?
Third draft is when we're starting to more specifically talk about author's choices and connecting that to the meaning of the text.
So that's, and back to the guiding question.
Very good.
All right.
So this is by Gavin Francis, and it was published in the London Review of Books. Now, that's important to think about because the London Review of Books is not a science magazine. It's a literary magazine. So that's an interesting place where that was published.
What do you say we give it a go and read this thing aloud?
Let's do it.
Students, if you want to look down below the video, you can have a copy as well and you can read along with us.
Okay, let's hear it. You start.
Before stethoscopes were invented, physicians would listen to their patients' hearts by laying one ear directly onto the skin of the chest. We are accustomed to laying our heads against the breast of our lovers, our parents, or our children. But once or twice, when I've rushed out on an urgent house call, leaving my stethoscope behind, I've had to rediscover the traditional method. It's an odd sensation, intimate yet detached, to apply your ear to the chest of a stranger. It helps if you stick your finger in the unoccupied ear. Once you tune out all the background noise, you begin to hear the sound of blood as it makes its way through the chambers and valves of the heart. The classical belief was that blood traveled to the heart in order to be mixed with the vital spirit, or pneuma, rarefied from the air by the lungs. The ancients must have imagined a churning within, air frothing with blood, the way wind whips up waves on the sea. The first time I placed my ear to a patient's chest, I was reminded of holding a conch shell as a child, listening to the imagined ocean within.
When any fluid is forced through a narrow opening, there is turbulence. And just as a river flooding through a narrow canyon can be deafening, turbulence within the heart generates noise. Medical students are trained to listen very closely to the subtleties of those noises and to infer from them how narrow or obstructed are the canyons of the heart. There are four valves in the human heart. When they close, you hear two separate sounds. The first sound is made as the two largest valves, the mitral and the tricuspid, close at the same time during the active part of the beat, known as the systole, when blood is forced out of the ventricles and into the arteries. These valves are so broad that they have thick cords like harp strings attached to their cusps to reinforce them. The second sound is made by the other two valves, the pulmonary and the aortic, as they prevent backflow whilst the ventricles refill, diastole. Healthy cardiac valves close with a soft percussive noise like a gloved finger tapping on a leather-topped desk. If they are stiffened or incompetent, there are additional sounds, murmurs that can be high-pitched or low, loud or soft, depending on the steepness of the pressure gradient across the diseased valve and how turbulent the flow.
Starting out in medicine, I learned to tell the difference between valve pathologies by listening to a CD of murmurs. I put it on while studying, hoping that my subconscious would come to distinguish a seagull from a musical murmur, recognize the grade of mitral regurgitation from the trill of aortic stenosis. There was something comforting in listening to the gurgle of blood as I worked. I wondered if it recalled the sound of the sea or hearing a storm outside while wrapped up warm, but the sounds were too rhythmic for that. Perhaps it's the womb, I thought, a deep memory of my mother's pulse.
A pregnant woman came to my clinic who hadn't felt her baby move for a day or so and wanted me to reassure her by listening to its heartbeat. Normal stethoscopes are no use for listening to the heartbeat of a baby in the womb. The sound is too fast, quiet, and high-pitched. Midwives often use electronic Doppler probe to find the fetal heart, but I used a modified tube called a Pinard stethoscope, like an old-fashioned ear trumpet, wedged between one ear and the swollen contour of the woman's belly. The best place to lay the trumpet is where you think you felt the convex curve of the baby's spine. Even with one finger in my other ear, it took a little while to find the heart, an agonizing couple of minutes for the mother. But there it was, a rhapsodic, syncopated interleaving of her heartbeat with her baby's. The fetal heartbeat was distinct, fluttering fast like a bird over the oceanic swell of the mother's pulse, an allegro played over an adagio. I paused for a moment, listening to the two rhythms within one, two lives within one body.
Mr. Giles, that is a fantastic piece of writing. You know, I have to say, I remember examining this one a few years ago. I think I did about 500 of these two plus full sets. Okay.
Yeah. And I'm blown away by his passion as a doctor and his intricate detail to, and how intimate he is with the human heart and how much he makes it feel just so powerful and human.
Yeah. And I love how he's really tapping into sort of the history of medicine and connecting the past to the present and really just unifying this in a beautiful piece of writing.
Yeah. And to be honest, there's some sentences that I need to read three or four times to understand some of the scientific terms. And I might never understand exactly some of that scientific language, but I think it's really accessible and interesting. So now we want to go on to our second draft, Mr. Cohen. What are we doing in this second draft?
Well, typically, Mr. Giles, when I have a complex text like this, I like to go down the left-hand margin and just kind of summarize what it is I've seen, because sometimes it's so difficult. I just want to make sure I've understood the literal meaning of the text.
Yeah, that's right. So in that first paragraph, we know that he's talking about a traditional way that doctors didn't use stethoscopes to listen to the human heart, and also how modern doctors can use those old methods and not use the stethoscope to listen to the heart.
Yeah, and closing that first paragraph, we see him reflecting on his own experiences and sort of conjuring up memories from his time at the seaside as a child comparing that. That's really nicely done.
That's right. In the second paragraph, we see him talking about abnormalities and how medical students listen to the heart for the subtle differences to be able to identify abnormalities in the heart. This is the scientific paragraph.
Yeah, and then that paragraph continues. We get some really rich scientific description of the heart. You know, this is something that perhaps a med student would appreciate more than two English teachers like Cohen and Giles.
Yeah. Third paragraph is him reflecting and being nostalgic about when he learned how to listen to the heart using listening to records and thinking a little bit about trying to identify different features of the heartbeat.
Yeah, and of course the passage ends with this really interesting anecdote where he's working with a pregnant woman, and he's sort of thinking about the connectivity between the mother and the fetus, the traditional and the scientific. It's just a really beautiful close to this piece.
Yeah, that's great. All right, let's move on now to our third draft, Mr. Cohen. What's the third draft, and tell us about our colors?
Yeah, so the third draft, folks, is when you want to really get in there and look for those little textual references that you may use and pin those to literary features, all while considering the guiding question. So in this case, I want to think about the references that I want to use. Those will be blue. And anytime I find a feature, I want to think, is that more literary? If it is, I'll make it green. Or is that more scientific? And then, okay, in that case, I'll highlight it as yellow in the right-hand margin.
Right. So we notice in the first paragraph, and that first paragraph is very rich with lots of literary elements. We see an allusion to the past, where he's talking about the past and the ancients. We also see the use of inclusive pronouns, but the inclusive language, but also that second person. He's really putting us in the passage, and I thought that was clever. And then that sort of rich figurative language, the metaphor at the end, and all that motif of the ocean, where he's comparing the blood with the wind, with, you know, the blood and the rhythm of the heart with the wind whipping up waves on the sea. That's such a powerful way to end that.
Yeah, and folks, now going back to the guiding question, you can see that we've highlighted all of those in green because we feel that the beginning of this passage is very literary in nature, and that really would focus on that aspect of the guiding question.
I think so. What about the second body?
Yeah, the second paragraph, we see a continuation of this rich figurative language with the discussion of canyons, Mr. Giles. But as we go further through the passage and we talk about the medical students, we see some scientific jargon. We see words like valves, mitral, tricuspid, systole. Right? Diastole. These are words that I don't really know. I don't even know if I'm pronouncing them right, to be honest. But I know that those are clearly, that's an example of scientific jargon, and therefore I'm going to light that up in yellow.
Yeah, it's a complex part of the text for sure. But notice how he's interspersing some of that scientific jargon. He's combining that with interesting similes and bringing that motif of music and really interesting comparisons to the soft glove finger tapping on the lever top desk. That's really clever.
That back and forth is highly visible in the right hand column, Mr. Giles. You see that alternating yellow, green. So that's really the author's really playing with the scientific and the literary as he communicates his message.
Yeah,
and let's move down a bit further, Giles.
He continues to do that when he talks about his own personal anecdote of listening to the human heart. And he's again, that motif of the ocean comes out again. So that tends to be a motif running throughout this whole text. I thought it's really interesting.
Yeah, and then getting into the close of the passage, again, that part with the pregnant woman and the baby and listening to the heartbeat, we see this really nice blend of scientific language, Doppler probe, Pinard stethoscope, etc. But then we get this beautiful literary craft at the end where we see, this motif of music coming back in and really the unity, the rhythm of it all coming together. It's just a really nice close. So again, that alternating literary and scientific goes through the passage to the end.
Yeah, there's really an essence of being human in this passage and this whole idea of the heart representing life and blood and also just the mystery of life, like the mystery of this baby in this woman's belly, but also the mystery of the human heart. Such a great way.
And also the mystery of the historical practices that doctor used juxtaposed with the current medical practices. And Gavin Francis is saying there's a place for both. We need both of them.
Yeah, and I think this passage is really inviting us to come up with an interpretation and to think about that. So that brings up our next point. We want to think about offering a thesis statement for this particular passage. And what do you think is going on here that we want to talk about?
Mr. Giles, I definitely want to use the language of the guiding question. I want to think about words like literary and scientific. I definitely want to capture this notion of mystery of the human heart, and I really want to play with this interplay between modern physicians and physicians of the past. So what do you say we take a stab at it? Why don't you read the thesis out loud?
Yeah, that's great. Through the combination of the literary and the scientific, Gavin Francis conveys the complexity, beauty, and mystery of the human heart, all while arguing that modern physicians should apply ancient beliefs to current medical practice.
Giles, that's a big sentence.
That's big.
What are your thoughts on this?
I love the idea of the complexity because that's part of that scientific. And I love the beauty. You think of the beauty of music, the beauty of, all the musical motif, but also the sort of mystery of the ocean. I think it really captures a lot of that sort of literary and scientific. And then the last part is that argument about sort of how we should actually look to ancient beliefs and what we can learn from them. I think that's a really intelligent.
Me too. Personally, as a writer, I may have broken that into two sentences, but I do believe this student has pulled it off and it is grammatically accurate.
Yeah.
Now, Giles, what's the next step? Now that I have my thesis, I'm still not ready to write.
That's right.
What do I need to do next?
We want to think about a rudimentary outline. How are we going to outline our ideas and how might we want to organize these ideas into a coherent paper?
I'll take the first one because I know I'm starting with an introduction.
Okay.
I want to start with an introduction where I identify the author, probably mention the text type, and sort of capture that big idea leading down into my thesis.
Yeah, so then my first body paragraph could be this classic medical practice and the lack of tools, but the high degree of intimacy that I want to talk about.
Yeah, I think the next thing I might focus on, Mr. Giles, would be sort of, how you can use the sounds of the heart to detect abnormalities, and that doesn't have to be done through modern medicine. We can use old practices to do that.
Okay, I like that. And then we're going to talk about that nostalgic reflection where we see the author thinking about like learning how to listen to the heart.
Yeah, and I really, I mentioned it several times. I love the last paragraph. So I really want to celebrate that intimacy that Gavin Francis is talking about, that blend between the traditional and the modern scientific way of examining the heart. And I want to capture that with a really positive tone and really capture the beauty in that paragraph.
Yeah, that's great. So I want you guys to notice that this...
Time out. Are we going to conclude this thing?
Yeah, no. Then we're going to conclude the, then we're going to conclude the piece. We're going to think about the so what to this. There's a lot to say about the human heart that we want to think about. But I think the takeaway that I wanted to mention is that, you know, you notice that this rudimentary outline focuses on ideas. We're thinking about the key ideas. We're thinking about the guiding question, and we're trying to come up with good topics for body paragraphs, but we're also following the structure of this particular piece.
Folks,
it lends itself to that.
We highly discourage making literary choices the topic of a paragraph. I think you want to have good, strong ideas in your rudimentary outline and in your topic sentences, and then use the features to supplement and support those ideas.
Yeah. So we hope this video, I know it's detailed, and I know this is a hard text, but we hope this video gave you some tools for how to read a text closely, how to think about those ideas in the left-hand side of the margin to start to really annotate with intention and then arrive at a good thesis and create an outline. And now I'm excited to write. I want to put my pen to paper.
Well, I'll tell you what, folks, you come back for the next video, you're going to see an outstanding piece of student writing, and we're going to talk about how to go from ideas to awesome writing. So check your next video, okay? Thank you for joining, and we'll see you next time.
Thanks, guys.